I've lived in London all my life, right through the war, and I've only ever referred to it as Waterloo Bridge. I've never known it to be the Ladies' Bridge.
Ladies' Bridge?
Yeah. Have you heard it being called the Ladies' Bridge before?
Never, no.
Now look at these pictures, you women war workers, and you men too.
They were just approaching Waterloo Bridge. This was built mainly by female labour during the Second World War. This is why we call it the Ladies' Bridge. And if it wasn't for the ladies in this country would have fell into disrepair.
I am delighted because it's a story I'd heard a little bit about but didn't know a huge amount, because it was nicknamed the Ladies' Bridge.
Waterloo Bridge was rebuilt by women during the Second World War. There's actually no historical written evidence about it. No one's documented it.
What we're trying to do is to celebrate the fact that there were many thousands of women who worked in construction during the war, but it's an untold story.
We were taken onto the bridge, a group of Cambridge undergraduates. I certainly don't remember seeing any women on the Waterloo Bridge.
The rumour goes that it was the ladies of the night, you know. The Union Jack Club is just before it, and there were several houses in Blackfriars Road of notable repute, you know. So we always took the idea that it was the ladies of the night.
Went to school in St John's. At St John's School, which is just by the bridge, but I cannot remember seeing women working on the bridge.
I came to London in the late 70s and managed to get on a training course to train as a carpenter and joiner. And we thought we were pioneers. We thought we were the first women to have done this. But only 35 years previous, there were thousands and thousands of women doing building trades. But there was no trace of these women. There were no photographs. There was nothing, no history of these women at all, apart from the story kept alive by the riverboat pilots about the women who built Waterloo Bridge.
Until a few months ago, I was carrying on with my peacetime job in an office. One day, whilst my boss was phoning, I noticed an advertisement in his newspaper. It said, "Give us the planes and bombs we want." Although I wasn't due for call-up for some time, I decided I would go to the employment exchange the same day.
There was jobs galore. There was absolutely jobs galore. You could go anywhere.
As a woman as well?
Yeah, because all the men were
away
or doing their national service, they were crying out.
With complete confidence, girls have taken on the work. Even when it is unavoidably heavy work, they do it with a will and enable the train services to run on time and up to schedule.
And I took a job that a man did. They used to book freight on the shipping lines, and they said to me that I could do this job, but as soon as the man came back from the war, I would have to leave the job and take something lesser, really.
The farther you go into war industry, the more surprised you are at the things nowadays being done by women. They even operate the steam hammer.
I got a job in over Smithfield Meat Market, Union Cold Storage it was.
Yes.
I was a laboratory assistant.
That was posh.
Yeah.
Very posh.
And thousands are in the picturesque Land Army. On them, the country will rely for a large part of the increased acreage which must be put under the plough.
I like the uniform.
Land Army uniform was
quite glamorous, wasn't it?
It was quite glamorous.
I had a letter from the government saying there were six subjects. One of the subjects was aeronautics. So I took a leap in the dark to find I was one of five girls doing engineering. Much later on, we discovered there'd only been nine ever before.
It wasn't long before Mary and I were entering the factory ready for work. All the glass in the windows and the roof had been taken away for safety, and the factory blacked out.
I arrived in the experimental flight test department at Langley, and you could see by the look in the men's eyes, oh my God, there's a war on and we've got a woman engineer too. So I couldn't ever let anyone down.
As it flew off, I felt that I was answering that pilot in the advertisement, helping to give him and the rest the planes they need. And I know other girls are helping to give them bombs and ammunition. But many more women are needed if all the jobs are to be done properly. And the training centres are there to show how.
So we all know about women who worked on the railways and the trams and the buses in both the First World War and the Second World War, but nothing about building. Even in popular sort of history, they just leave out the construction industry.
Let's go back to Waterloo Bridge a bit. Why was it knocked down in the first... Do you see what I mean? Do you know the story? Tell us the story.
There was a buckle that appeared at the north side of the bridge. It had a kind of like a bit of a hill. They built a temporary bridge. And then in 1939, they started working on the rebuilding of the bridge.
The Waterloo Bridge was frightfully important to London. We were afraid it would be stopped because of the war, and they said no, the government said it was far too important to a job and we very much needed this extra bridge, and so they carried on. And the women supplemented the men, had to do as they required.
There was this acute labour crisis that happened in 1939 when all the Irish concrete workers who were working on the bridge disappeared overnight. They all sort of went back to Ireland when war was declared. But the craft trade unions were really resistant to women coming in whatsoever. The construction company argued for more time and more money because of their particular labour problems. They used this phrase, we've utilised every type of labour possible. Green labour, which is sort of unskilled. They don't actually say, we've had to use women, for God's sake.
In 1941 was depths of despair about the war. I mean, the only thing that kept us going was Churchill saying we're going to win, but we had no allies.
I first came across evidence that women had worked in considerable numbers going through the Labour Gazette, and I discovered that there were thousands and thousands of women who entered the building industry in 1941. So the agreement with the government during the war years was to let women in on a temporary basis, and also insisted that they were paid far less than men.
This is a salute to women in war work. In steelworks, women operate the crane carrying ladles of molten metal.
I'd be standing there welding like that with a gun. We didn't have all the modern stuff that they got now.
No job could require more care than this, as obviously a slip on the part of the crane driver might result in a nasty accident.
I'd look down and my trousers would be alight.
Till now, however, the women in heavy industry have been out of the limelight. Let that be so no longer. Let us now see to it that the proper praise is given to them, and couple with them the women who do a score of thankless but essential jobs left vacant by the men who fight.
While you're welding, you mustn't dare look either way. No, 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 this is your... And they'd say, give us one of her fags. Give us one of her fags. And I could hear all this. And you had to carry your bag about with you wherever you went.
By 1944, there were nearly 25,000 women working in the construction industry. I mean, literally, I couldn't believe it when I saw the records.
Give me land, lots of land, among the starry skies above. Don't fence me in.
For me, that was the most exciting find, finding these photographs in the Imperial War Museum. And finding photographs of women doing building work, all across the trades, from labouring, concrete workers, to up to the skilled trades, carpenters and joiners, bricklayers, and there they all were. And then, because it was a building of strategic importance, there was absolute censorship on all news about the bridge. There's some wonderful photographs from the London Metropolitan Archives about the building of the bridge up until 1939.
There must be, I mean, I'm just thinking, if you spent from 1942 to 1945 working on a bridge and the day it was finished, there's got to be photographs. There's got to be women standing there going, look what we did. Must be somewhere. Are they not in an archive?
The difficulty with the Peter Lind records were that when the company went into liquidation in the 1980s, a lot of the information was just either thrown in skips or pillaged by people that wanted a keepsake or a memento of their time with Peter Lind. And it was generally well known, that anecdotally if you like, that there were women working. And in fact, names of a particular lady was given to me at the time, and there was mention of the fact that she lived in a place called Houghton Regis. And the reason I've remembered that, but not her name, unfortunately, was the fact that I used to live nearby.
Performing the ceremony is Mr. Herbert Morrison.
I am very, very glad this morning to open the new Waterloo Bridge. I will proceed to cut the tape and to declare the new Waterloo Bridge to be open.
The new bridge was still on timber supports when the war began. After more than 20 air raid incidents, its six traffic lines were ready for use by the end of last year.
And the opening of the bridge, in fact, the formal opening, was in 1945, and Herbert Morrison made a very sort of rousing speech in which he thanked the fortunate men who built this bridge.
No.
Yes.
Really?
No mention of women at all. Absolutely none. Written out completely.
It now remains for London to take to heart Mr. Morrison's words. Keep it white, he says. Its whiteness is one of its glories.
I would have had something to say if I wasn't mentioned and I had helped to build it.
Even though the women worked during the war, it was still a man's world.
I've been on the River Thames all my life, and nowhere else. My occupation is taking passengers on sightseeing tours on the River Thames.
I tell them that this is the Waterloo Road Bridge, but we all call it the Ladies' Bridge because it was actually built by over 65% of female labour during the Second World War.
Some say 90%, some say 85% labour, but in the national newspaper it was mentioned that it was over 70% labour was female labour to build the bridge.
Sometimes I also say this was built by the ladies of London, and I'm amazed it's still standing, and I usually get a few boos, you know.
Everything was so hush-hush. You're talking about the Waterloo Bridge. I mean, I was no distance, was I, from the Waterloo Bridge, but I didn't know what was going on there. And it certainly wasn't broadcast.
The thing about this story is that it was a story, it's an urban myth. So I was hoping, like most historians want, to find a cache of letters, a deposit in an archive, maybe the sort of the diary of a woman who'd actually worked on the bridge, in the same way that you were hoping to find a woman still alive who could tell her story of working on the bridge. The other thing is that when you're doing manual work, you're really, really tired. I mean, it's highly unlikely that, you know, many women have got the energy to, at the end of a really hard day, wheeling barrows full of concrete in incredibly difficult conditions, are they really going to go home and write a diary about their experiences on Waterloo Bridge? There came a point when I did start to doubt whether there was any truth in this story about women on the bridge. You know, maybe it was just a story. I mean, it was one of those urban myths. It was one of those things that tourists are told as they go up and down the Thames.
So I had no home at my own. I was bombed out. I'd lost my home. I was bombed right out. I had nothing at all. So she let me have a room in hers. And my boss said to me, I think you've got a little girl, missus. Moss. So I said, yes, I'll have you heard enough about her.
Looks a bit rough. Who lives there?
People called Finch. Mother and daughter.
We got a job here for her. If she's anything like you, he said, we'll have her. She came into the factory when she was 14 years of age. But they called her the Whippet.
They were awful, those doodlebugs. I think they were worse than the bombs because they used to fly over and directly they stopped.
You knew they were going to come down.
They were going to come down, but you didn't know exactly which way to run because they seemed to follow you, didn't they?
Mm.
It was awful, absolutely awful. And I don't think we realised how bad the war was till we watch what's on the telly today. And we see these people running, and that's what we used to do.
All the localities, South London, was being bombed, and quite often people wouldn't turn up for work, because their neighbourhood had been sort of destroyed, and there were real difficulties around the Waterloo area in terms of keeping people housed and able to come to work.
Wish me luck as you wave me goodbye. Cheerio, here I go on my way. Wish me luck as you wave me goodbye. Oh, give me a smile I can keep, all the one in my heart.
What was it again?
And the name of the guest they used was Ethel Dinklerasi.
Oh.
Now, I can remember that, but I can't remember things you want me to remember.
I have to say, I'm afraid, so much of women's history, much of it has entirely disappeared, and it'll be an oral history, won't it, rather than something written down.
Well, it's mainly passed down from people who have been older than me, who've worked on the river for longer than me. Most of the guides started in 1951 when people wanted to come on the river, and they wanted to know all the sights of London. I think it's a lovely bridge. It's got nice, generous curves on it, which probably because ladies built it.
And when the ladies do build this bridge, they always do a nice little touch.
They put a nice, clean touch to it.
It's been finished off on either side with a fine, white,
self-cleaning Portland stone. And so that when it rains in London,
which isn't very often,
the bridge actually self-cleans.
Well, somebody must remember it.
Excuse me, interrupting. I presume that you've tried the internet, have you?
If you worked in construction, not just on Waterloo Bridge, but anywhere, as a woman, a lady, please ring us up now.
So any men who remember working with women as well?
Anything who has anything relating, particularly to the rebuilding of Waterloo Bridge.
Oh, I see your advert for people who knew about Waterloo Bridge in the Saga magazine. There was security here, men with guns to keep you away sort of thing, to allow any of the workers to be on the bridge. My father worked here for quite a few years on the bridge. The main company that had the bridge was a company called Peter Lynn. My father's main function on this Waterloo Bridge was he worked a crane putting cleating piles around the four arches and then filling with cement.
Do you remember actually seeing the ladies working?
I can remember seeing the ladies here, yeah. But there's lots of them. They were in your colour trousers mainly, except the ladies which were in a blue overall. The big, all in one. I think there's quite a few hundred ladies up here, and the ladies done the less technical jobs. That's not discriminatory. That's, the ladies done the more lifting and the tugging, where the men done the more crane work and the more of the technical type of work. you know. And the ladies were in two, I can remember they were in two grades of ladies. The ladies with the turbans and the dungarees, you know, with the bib up, were, there was more of them. But the ladies which were like a senior lady that could drive and could undertake a more of a technical job, they wore an all-in-one overall, a bit similar to the men.
Betty, it's very nice to have found you as survivor of the Peter Lind family. Do you have any memories of the Waterloo Bridge while it was being built during the war?
Yes, we'd go up and walk around, and that was on Saturdays and Sundays when the things were quiet.
It was true that Daddy had a lot of women that did help. But, you know, that's what happened with when the war came, that poor women had to sit to and lend a hand.
I think they probably didn't remember the women working on a bridge because they didn't look like women. You know, if you have a flat cap on and an overall, all in one, even today I have a lot of trouble to see who's a man, who's a lady, you know. My father, he used to love the ladies.
We were stationed at large camps where the men were as well. And as I say, we talked. We were allowed to say our piece. We weren't put down as the little woman at home. We were the same as the chaps.
In the finish, I ended up to make bridges for our soldiers to pass over. This is very important. It was spikes here, spikes here, spikes here. And I was making parts to go in that corner, making other parts to go in that corner. After I've done that, the men would have to go and do that because it was too heavy for me to carry. That's how it went. But I started it.
All over London, a fortress of freedom in the dark days, millions rejoice in final and complete victory after a war lasting nearly 6 years.
Every little life must go with a little life must go.
I could understand the married women and the older women giving up their jobs. But what about the young women?
You had to leave to give employment to the men coming home from the forces.
It was okay during the war when they were needed. After that,
yeah,
they had to go.
The men wanted their jobs, you know.
Once the war was over, they knew they'd have to go.
Yeah,
they didn't make a fuss.
6 years of war and complete upheaval. People wanted to get back to living a normal, happy family life again.
He expected that I was going to come back into the old form of just being the housewife and, you know, wife, as so did the government. But, you know, I'd had my bit of going out to work and I liked it. So that, you know, I didn't really want to settle down. And then that, I suppose, upset him. But it caused lots of problems.
Well, I wasn't quite the lady that I used to be. No. It was just that you got into some of their ways, you know. It's only natural. Very nice and all that. I mean, people respected you for what you did do.
Everybody had some problem or another, because we weren't the same women, really, and they weren't, you know, they were young fellas that went away, come back, they're serious men.
But I hated that man because I loved that job. I enjoyed the job, it was lovely, because it had a foreign element. Everything was exported or imported, because that's what London was in those days. So then when the man came back, I went into the accounts department.
Under the pressure of war necessity, woman has entered a new field, one in which it was thought not very long ago she could not possibly succeed. She has succeeded brilliantly.
So in 1945, women made up over 3% of manual workers in the construction industry. 2005, they make up 1%. So there were more proportionally then than there are now. But those who access work on building sites, their contracts were terminated. They effectively were sort of ousted in favour of men. But there's a record of a conference called by women who worked in construction, asking the trade unions to change and let women in alongside men. And they wanted the government and the country to utilise their skills. They wanted to be part of reconstructing Britain. They wanted to build the new Britain and they wanted to help. And it didn't happen.
When you tell them that you were a welder during the war, how do most
people react? Don't believe me. Don't believe me now. No, they don't. I was in hospital and the man said, yeah, the war, this and the war, that. And I said, yeah, I can remember the war very much. Well, what did you do? I said, electric welding in the war. Well, yeah, you didn't do nothing. I said, didn't I? And I told him, no, she never done electric welding. Had a she not bad electric welding and women's stuff. Didn't believe it, couldn't believe it. But it was perfectly true.
Now, let's talk about the women's involvement in Waterloo Bridge. I imagine a lot of people don't know it.
Yeah, well, up until 2 weeks ago, we only had hearsay, we only had oral records. And then Christine Wall went back on to check the archives and she found in Bradford Museum of Film and Television, she found photos of women welders on dismantling the old Waterloo Bridge.
Oh, wow.
Three women. Actually welding.
Well, I can't believe that there isn't somebody in London who at some point with their aunt, their granny, their mum walked across Waterloo Bridge and she patted one of the railings and went, I helped to build this.
Now, thousands of Londoners cross Waterloo Bridge every day, but I wonder how many know the huge role that women played in building it during the Second World War. Now, their role has been officially recognised.
A historian uncovered these pictures proving the women's role. Named only as Dorothy, this welder was photographed at work a year before the bridge opened in 1945. And while the listing's amendment may only be a few sentences, it means the role women played will be recognised forever.
Let me be by myself in the evening breeze. Listen to the murmur of the cottonwood trees. Send me off forever, but I ask you please, don't fence me.
Just turn me loose, let me straddle my old saddle underneath the western sky. On my cayuse, let me wander over yonder till I see the mountains rise. Give me land, lots of land under starry skies. Don't fence me in. Let me ride through the wide country that I love. Don't fence me in. Let me be by myself in the evening breeze and listen to the murmur of the cottonwood trees. Send me off forever, but I ask you please, don't fence me in. Just turn me loose, let me straddle my old saddle underneath the western skies.
On my cayuse, let me wander over yonder till I see the mountains rise.
Ba 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 ba. I want to ride to the ridge where the west commences and gaze at the moon till I lose my senses and I can't look at hobbles and I can't stand fences. Don't fence me in, no.
Papa, don't you fence me in.